Then Jesus said unto them, when you have lifted up the Son of Man, then shall you know that I am he, and that I do nothing of myself, but as my Father hath taught me, I speak these things. And he that sent me is with me. The Father hath not left me alone, for I do always these things that please him. As he spoke these words, many believed on him. Then Jesus said to those Jews which believed on him, if you continue in my word, then you are my disciple indeed. And you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. They answered him, we be Abraham's seed, and were never in bondage to any man. How sayest thou, ye shall be made free? Jesus answered them, verily, verily, I say unto you, whosoever committeth sin is the servant of sin. And the servant abideth not in the house forever, but the Son abideth forever. So if the Son therefore shall make you free, you shall be free indeed. The word of God for people of God. Today I want to entitle this text today with the sermon title, To Be Honest. To Be Honest. Anybody who is a Facebook junkie and who surfs the internet will be very familiar with the words TBH. It is an acronym that means to be honest. And most times when you see it, it is posting something, the person is revealing something true about their nature. They're disclosing something about their identity and their feelings to perhaps shed light on who they are as people. And can I say today, to be honest, that when we look at this month of Black History, there have been a lot of things swept under the rug in our culture and in our communities. The fact of the matter is that we have been a people who have become so used to being in bondage, not only physically, but mentally, socially, and spiritually. How can we forget those images of the 60s, of those freedom fighters who fought on behalf of all humankind to find liberation from the oppression of a society, recognized society, that wanted to dominate, that wanted to keep us in bondage? How can we forget how can we forget Martin Luther King and Rosa Parks? How can we forget our forefathers of ages past? And it's something about history that if you don't learn from history, somebody said that it will repeat itself. And can I be honest with you this morning? Racism has changed its nature. No, it's still the same way. It has replaced the hood for a Brooks Brothers suits. It has replaced, it is no longer white, but now we have discrimination that is black. Don't act like you don't know what I'm talking about. They have the keys to the executive washroom. There's some folks right now who know all too well what it feels like to be in bondage, to be discriminated against. There, do I have a witness? If you come from one side of Baltimore and step into another side of Baltimore, you might find yourself in the wrong neighborhood and somebody might discriminate against you. No, but it's not only in our community. We find some biases in our own homes. We have husbands and wives who are at each other's throats and can't get along. We have children who are at mothers and fathers' throats who can't get along because of something that happened long time ago. And to be honest, we've all been living a lie, even in the church. We've been living a lie. We have a piousness about ourselves, a religiosity that makes us feel as if we're worthy, as if we know somebody, as if we have a lie because we come to church every Sunday, because we know all the books of the Bible, because we've been here a long time. But can I be honest with you? Some of us are blinded. We have become blinded. We have become at ease and dying in our own religiosity. We have become at ease and dying in our own way of thinking. And today, Daniel, today, as we look at this text today, Jesus here is just right on the outskirts of meeting a woman who had been brought before him, who was caught in the very act of adultery. We talked about that a few Sundays ago. This lady was brought to Jesus, and then the folks said, well, listen here, Jesus, we caught this lady in the very act of sin. And what they really were trying to do, if you remember on the last time we preached, they were really trying to trap Jesus. And what Jesus did was he sat down and he started writing in the sand. And as he was writing, he said, now he that is without sin cast the first stone. Y'all remember that? And then the end result was that those who had accused her had walked away and she was left all alone. And he looked at the lady and said, woman, where are your accusers? And then he told the lady, now get up and don't sin anymore. And from that place, he gets in another discussion with these Pharisees, with these Jews who wanted to really question his identity and if he really belonged. Jesus is having a discussion, and while he's having a discussion, he offers a piece of his identity. And let me tell you something here. Let me tell you something here, Daniel. There are three things that Jesus allowed these Pharisees and Jewish people to realize about themselves. Number one, they were in bondage. The first thing is that they were in bondage, slaves to the law. They knew the Torah. They were professionals. They knew the Torah. They knew all of the words of the Torah. They knew the way to live. They were slaves to the law. And it is possible to be a professional churchgoer. It is possible to become a professional Christian without principle. These Pharisees were professionals, but they had no principles. And when you get to a place where you only think about the job and the law more than you do about the principles behind the law, then you become nothing more than just another piece of tag-tag religion. And Jesus pointed out that you are a slave, first of all, to the religion. Did you remember them? They brought the woman to it, and the only thing they could quote was the law. And oftentimes, folk coming to church today, they come with some problems, with some issues. And the only thing you want to do is quote what the rules say, what the discipline says this, and what the bylaws say. We know the professions, but we have lost the principle of love. If you really want to know what was the guiding force in the struggle for human and civil rights, it was a principle underlined by love. And they had perfection, but had no love. They loved the law more than they did the people. And sometimes you get trapped in loving this church building and loving the people or the pews and the stuff more than we do the Lord our God. They were trapped. They were trapped. They were in bondage to the law. But not only that, they were slaves to sin. They could not escape the fact that they were slaves to sin. And all of us have some sin in us. I don't care how big or how bad or how much Christian you are, how many degrees you have. All of us got some sin in us. For the Bible says in Romans, all of us have sinned and come short of the glory of God. But the problem with these folk was they became slaves to that sin. And all of us have been there at one point where we've had food become the addict that we savor. And all of us have been there when if it's not the food, it's the cigarettes. If it's not the cigarettes, it's the alcohol. If it's not the alcohol, it's the golf course. If it ain't the golf course, it's your job. That becomes slaves to sin. And whatever you put before God becomes your God. And if you put that before your worship of God, but you have literally become a slave to sin. And here they are judging this lady. Here they are trying to trap Jesus, but they were slaves to sin. But not only that, they were slaves to the devil. Yeah, they were slaves to the devil. They could not escape the fact that Jesus says later on in this text, he says that if you are born of me, you come from God, but those who are not born from God are of the devil. And we have some folk right now who do things not because they really know what they're doing, but sometimes they are guided by devilish ways. There are some folk who are slaves to the devil. They go around looking for ways to trap folk, looking for ways to undercut folk. And Jesus acknowledges all of these things. And what he does here, Daniel, is take us, and this text gives us a reason to face it. This text teaches us that those who follow Jesus ought to know these very basic truths. What are you saying? Is that you should know the truth, and the truth will make you free. He said, to be honest, if you want to know the truth shall make you free. The first truth, he says, you need to be true to yourself. That's the first truth. You can fool everybody. Anybody ever been on Facebook? I'm trying to make it real. Anybody on Facebook, you got some Facebook bullies. Yes. Folk who would get on Facebook and you would think that they were more than what they really are. Yes. You understand? They talk a mean game. You ever talk to somebody on the telephone? Have you ever met someone who tries to plump themselves bigger than what they really are? That make you think that they have accomplished all of this and much, much more than what truly is reality. You know, there were some guys when I was in the military. I got in the military and I told them, you know, for a little while I was in this occupation, and because I had not been what they were, they tried to make themselves bigger, their accomplishments in the military bigger than what they really had done. And what I discovered later on was this guy who was talking about being special forces. I found out he was just in the band. And the truth of the matter is that each of us lie to ourselves. We lie to ourselves thinking that willpower alone will help us with our struggle against sin, against what we know to be true in the law, and what we know how to fight the devil. We think that our willpower, if we can just stay strong within ourselves, that willpower is enough to get us through our tragedy. And what happens is that oftentimes, when you're not true to yourself, you start self-medicating. And there's some folk in here who self-medicating on sex, self-medicating on being a workaholic, self-medicating on the job and the career, self-medicating on alcohol, self-medication. Instead of recognizing that you've not been true to yourself, and when you really become true to yourself, the first thing you do is acknowledge, I can't do this by myself. God has sometimes allowed us to take on some challenges that we know we can't handle. We know we don't have $1 million to fix up this building. But until we come true to ourselves that this building will never be fixed unless we give it over to God, we'll keep on going through the same thing. It'll be a cycle that never ends. Until you come true to the reality that you gotta change some eating habits. I'm talking to self. I gotta stop eating all that salt and pork and fat and chicken. I gotta be true to myself. I'm no longer 17 where I can eat everything I wanna eat and still stay slim and maintain my weight. I gotta be true to myself. And maybe you haven't been true to yourself. That you've been walking the streets and walking your job and living your entire existence, but it's been a lie. And Jesus says, you're another truth. confront is being true to yourself. And not only should you be true to yourself, next thing you have to be, you got to be true. You got to know the true Jesus. And this word know in the Greek is an intimate word. The text says, you shall know the truth. And we know that Jesus is talking about himself because earlier he said, I am the way, the truth, and the light, and no man can come to the Father except by me. But the problem is, some of us are aware of who Jesus is, but the problem is we don't know him. See, this word know is also almost sexual. It means having an intimate knowledge about Jesus. That means you know exactly you and Jesus. You can text Jesus without taking out the cell phone. You can speak to Jesus without even having to call his name. When you know him, you get him early in the morning. Say, Lord, I thank you for waking me up this morning. When you know him, when you really know Jesus, if nobody ever comes by to visit you, if nobody ever say you did a good job, if nobody ever give you a penny for all the work you've done, it don't matter because I know Jesus. And the problem is that many of us really don't know Jesus. We know you came up here, you know you got that time, you came up here and sprinkled water on it, you came, got baptized, you went down a dry river, and you came up a wet river. You never knew him. And he wants to know, do you know me? Do you know me? Do you talk to me? When was the last time? Jesus, what have you done for me lately? Tell me myself, what have you done for me lately? Y'all was just saying. Instead of took. When was the last time you served instead of asking for somebody to do something for you? Jesus was saying, I want you to know me. I want you to know me like you know your wife and your husband. I want you to know me. I want to impregnate you with the word that's going to get you from those yesterday struggles to your today victory. I really want to know you. But the problem is, y'all, I give this analogy. Back in the old days, when I was little, you should write that down. It's a little girl, a couple rows of time. Do you like me? Yes, I know. And you had to circle that. And then they circle again. Then you say, do you want to go with me? And you just say, I just want to know if you want to go with me. Some of y'all don't want to go with them. Y'all just want to be there for the benefits. You want to call them when you're down and out, but you don't want to ride. You want to be my ride or die chick, you know. You want to be with me? Because if you really want to be with me, you got to pick up your cross. Or you're willing to suffer for my name's sake. It'll be a time when they talk about you. You got to know the truth, Jesus, eh? Ain't talking about Hudson. Hudson will let you down. I'm full of sin and iniquity. I'll disappoint you. You get close to me, you'll see the faults and my problems. You know, if you really knew who Hudson was, I'd be full of shame and show my faith. I got so much mess in me. But when you know Jesus, look at somebody and say, I just want to know Jesus. I want to know what he did. He died on the cross. They nailed him to the cross on a Friday. He hung there on Saturday, on Friday night. Do you know about that Sunday morning Jesus? Do you know about the Jesus who can speak to the midnight hour? I want to know, do you know him? Lastly, not only but you need true deliverance. I ain't talking about no counterfeit Jesus. Jesus says, you shall know the truth. Check this out, and the truth will set you free. ain't talking about the truth about how you do your money. Ain't talking about the truth about your education or your no education. I'm talking about true deliverance is when you acknowledge the fact that you're still a work in progress, and if you fall down, you can get back up again. Keep on trying. We need true deliverance in Baltimore City. Boys are on the corner selling drugs. We need true deliverance. And I want to ask you a question. Do you really want true deliverance? Do you want the kind of deliverance that you can go to sleep at night and wake up the next morning and say, I might have messed up, but God, I'm going to try again. Do you want true deliverance? And God is trying to say to you today is that I don't want you to have the kind of deliverance that you come down here sitting at the cross, you're sorry, but I want you to have the kind of deliverance that will break the chains. Anybody need the chains broken today? Yet when he died on the cross, the Bible said that he died for our sin. He broke the chains. And right now God is saying, I'm going to break the chains for you. But you've got to be true to yourself. You got to know the true Jesus. And then you got to get true deliverance. And true deliverance is not going to come if you keep on making excuses.
Come on now.
Maybe there's somebody here today who never really been truly delivered. You know, these Jews, because Jesus is now talking to those who believe him. The others didn't. So he's talking to these guys, and he tells them, look at the next part of this text. They said, we ain't never been slaves. We're from the descendants of Abraham. It's possible to be in church your whole life and live a lifetime of being bound in chains. It's possible to come to church Sunday after Sunday and still not love anybody, be hateful and mean, and talk about folk and be jealous. It's possible to be an usher, to be a choir member, to be a preacher, and not truly be delivered. And I come to tell you that I know somebody who can bring you true deliverance today. He says, if you confess with your mouth,
yes.
Check this out. If you just say, confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus Christ and believe in your heart. Do you believe? Do you believe? Do you believe that he's a healer? Do you believe that he can bring your marriage back together? Do you believe that he wants you to be successful and prosperous? Did you believe, Sister Mo? Did you really believe? Do you believe that he can wipe your past clean and give you a new start? Do you believe? Well, this is the time that you can come up and say, God, I believe. I'm ready to make a change in my life. Because after you have true deliverance, here's the bonus, you can have true change. Is that one today? Is that right? Praise God. Hallelujah. Praise God. I know there's another. Stand. I know there's another. Is that brother who's looking for the truth? True change. I mean, come on, y'all. Brother Cliff was up there. Look at him. He was singing. And he just blacked out. But you know what? When he fell off the fence, he fell in the arms of Jesus. And God said, I got this. Y'all with me?
Come on.
Yes.
Are you going to serve this church with your time?
stuff like a lot. Your talents and your finances. You ain't got to do something back. But if you got some time, you mind coming down and taking a hammer and against something? You mind going out to the community and telling somebody else about the goodness of the Lord? All right, amen. But we have new women's classes that meet on the first and the fourth Sunday. Our Bible study starts this week.